Hi, welcome to New Electromagnetism Applications number 8. This is Distinti's free energy generator. According to ethereal mechanics, massive bodies consume ether. Ether is flowing constantly down in all directions on the Earth. And ether is a reference frame for magnetism and induction. If you want to see more about this, you can go to the video, Foundation Series video EMF006. So therefore, an ether turbine propelled by earthward falling ether will provide abundant free energy. A turbine operated in reverse will provide a Starship propulsion system. The first step in this whole project is to first detect the flow of ether falling earthward. Just, you know, this is going to be the sanity check. Now don't look at this as just the Hoth shield generator. I just need a nice little picture for the page. This is artist's rendition. So let's start with something simple. Okay, the purpose of starting with something simple is to demonstrate the scale of what we're up against. And scale is going to be very important. So with a simple magnetometer, if I were to charge a sphere, a conductive sphere, put a charge on it, and put that on the desktop, and as the ether is flowing down through the sphere, it's going to generate a magnetic field. That magnetic field should be detectable with a sensitive magnetometer. So what's the minimum? Well, the smallest measurement that can be made with the magnetometer that we have available there is 2 milligauss. But I don't like working in gauss, so let's put it into the old units of Tesla. So we take this and we divide by 10,000, and that puts it into that the smallest measurement from the device is 2 times 10 to the minus Tesla. Okay. But we're getting out of using these classical units, and we're going to put these into the new ethereal mechanics unit, and we're just going to divide by km, which actually puts it into the old unit of amperes per meter, which is 2 amperes per meter, which in my opinion is a much simpler unit to use. It makes more sense than a Tesla or a Gauss or whatever. So using a simple approximation, this is an approximation, there's no vectors here, this is just for, gives magnitude, is if we take the charge on the sphere, multiply it by its velocity through the ether, and at a distance r from the sphere, we should see a magnetic field of intensity h amperes per meter. And so we already have the velocity, we know what the minimum h we can measure is, and we're going to just pick arbitrarily 1 meter away and see, well, how much charge do we need? And so if we work that back out, we come out and say, well, we need 182 microcoulombs, which doesn't seem so bad. Okay, but what voltage do I have to put on that sphere to get 182 microcoulombs? Well, if you do all the work and do the capacitance of a sphere and say, well, charge is equal to voltage times current and then divide for voltage, you end up with about 16 million volts for a 10 centimeter sphere. And I know what you're saying, oh gee, 16 million volts, oh crap. That's never going to get us free energy or get us to the stars and save the Earth. Now, in the couple of pages, I'm going to explain why this makes perfect sense and how we can mitigate this problem by changing the scale of things and make a more reasonable experiment out of it. And I'm going to show you, this is what separates the professionals from the amateurs. So the problem with anything in science and engineering is usually scale. Okay, if we were to drop the distance between the sphere and the sensor from 1 meter to 1 centimeter, okay, we have to make the sphere smaller, make the sphere half a centimeter. Well, that works out then, we only need 33 kilovolts. So we're getting better. Okay, so already we have a 500 time improvement just by changing 100 centimeters. You know, going from 100 centimeters to 1 centimeter. And there are other things you can do or alter the scale. You can go up in frequency. You can increase the voltage. You can increase the current or the charge or reduce or expand the distance depending on how the equation says the best way to do it is. Or get a more sensitive instrument. And so, you know, with all these things you can change, getting a scale change of a billion is a pretty easy thing to do if you have good models and you know what you're doing. And this makes sense, that these forces at the benchtop level, or the desktop level, however you want to say it, of that scale, these forces are so tiny. Okay, but when that reason why atoms are the size they are is because when those distances go down to the size atoms are, those forces become incredibly powerful. And that's why atoms are the tiny size they are. They're scaled down because that's where the forces make sense for them. And that's why things on the desktop that are, you know, people playing with magnets on a desktop, they don't know what they're doing. They're playing with things that are just out of their league. Okay, even solar panels, in order to get free energy from the sun, because the solar panels are free energy after you make the initial investment, what you get from the sun is free, unless, of course, the government finds a way to tax sunlight. But in order to get solar panels to work, they have to work down to crystalline level of silicone and with tiny doping and all this stuff in order for these things to begin to yield realizable, useful energy. This isn't something that a solar cell cannot be made when some tinkerer in his garage. You need specialized equipment to get down to the scale where the band gap levels are at the level where you can take advantage of them, that there's such a tiny scale. And then, once you do that, you need massive numbers of these cells in order to start getting some real useful power. So there's all this scaling going on. You're making it tiny to make it useful, and then you're putting millions of them in parallel or hundreds of them in parallel. Okay, all this scaling is going on to make a device, but you need models to do this. That's why quantification is important, because with the good models, you know how you can scale and in which ways you can scale. Okay, because you need models, and that's why you should not waste time. I know there's a guy out there, I'm not going to name his name, you know, I'm claiming that his theory of everything, his theory of magnets with his dielectricity and all this stuff is not quantifiable. That's complete and utter baloney. Or how about theories claiming a causal link to being observed, like quantum mechanics, or another theory requiring undetectable components to make the equations work. If you can't detect something, if you can't quantify it, it doesn't exist. So now you know the scale of what we're up against. And that's why when you look at these charlatans on YouTube with their little desktop experiments making light bulbs glow from these little things here, you're not going to be fooled by them, because you realize that we have a massive scale problem here. It's just either going to be go real tiny or go high voltage or go high frequency. Things that the average person isn't familiar with using or may not have access to or may not even know about. That's probably the bigger thing. So these things are garbage. It's not going to happen this easy. If it happened this easy with just a couple of coils of wire, somebody would have figured this out years ago. Tesla was playing around with coils more complicated than this, and he didn't see anything. If he did, he would have made a generator. But it's amazing to me how many people click on this garbage. And I'm trying to do real science, and I get virtually no traffic. It really pisses me off. So let me demonstrate now a way we can scale by a factor of 10 billion. Let's go to the lab. What we have here is a tiny Doppler radar. I mean, to give you a case of scale, twice the size of my thumb. This uses 10 gigahertz, so they're automatically right there going up in frequency. We get a scale of 10 billion. The question is it sensitive enough? That's what I have to do a lot of numbering and figuring out. But for now, let me just show you what this thing can do. It's pretty impressive. It's about $40. You can get it at Amazon. And it's for motion sensing. It doesn't do ranging. It just does Doppler motion sensing, which, you know, you can measure velocity with that. So let me put the camera on the scope to show you how sensitive it is. Now, what I'm going to do is disconnect my microphone, so because I'm going to go to the other side of the garage. I'm going to be about 15 feet away. I'm going to try to scream. See, as I'm moving away, the frequency gets hotter and hotter and hotter. Okay, now I'm going to stop. And you can see that the line has got almost nothing going on. And what I'm going to do is raise my hand. See, it's going crazy. Now all I'm going to do is wiggle my index finger back and forth. And now I'm going to stop. Okay, I'm about 15 feet away. Okay, I'm coming in now, and you can see it's going crazy just by me slowly walking in. So this thing is extremely sensitive. And the reason why I got this is because this gives me an output that I can actually read. It's not just a simple there's motion or there's no motion. I can actually use this signal output. This is actually the Doppler output of the device, like a regular radar system would give you a Doppler. And I think I can sample this and we can use this for experiments. I have to figure out exactly how, but it's possible. Let me show you what this was intended to replace. The whole reason why I went looking for this, I have had no idea that this thing actually ever existed. It might actually be pretty new, I don't know. But my purpose for the reason why I found this is pure accident. And I'm cleaning my garage, so forgive all of the crap going on here. The reason is this. So the cause is this. My light has a motion sensor on it. And you can see the motion sensor is that thing underneath the lights, and it's constantly on. I'm trying to work that motion sensor into my security system so I can record when the light goes on, because I can't really see out here near the garage except by the security camera, and I just don't want to sit in front of the security camera monitor all day. It'd be nice to have an indicator that something's in fact actually out here. Now, let's say if a package is delivered or somebody comes to visit, it'd be nice to know. They don't have a doorbell or anything. And so I was looking for a way to replace that with a better sensor. And the act of looking for it, that's when I came across this interesting device. Okay, so in this new project, which is going to be in parallel to the railgun project, okay, we're not stopping the railgun project, because the railgun project is very necessary, because it's already helped us to make discoveries about energy just making the magnet table. And that will be published in the area, the Patreon site, for Patreon subscribers. What we're going to do in this is we're going to explore two venues. We're going to explore the X-band Doppler measurement, because we've got to be able to detect the motion of the ether first. Then we can know, first of all, if it's there. If it's not there, then okay, we may have to rethink everything. So we need to do that one thing right now more than anything else, is prove that the ether is in fact falling earthward. And I've shown you what the scale is. The scale is very tiny, and so we need to do our proper scaling so we can make that effect, so it can be measured in a sure way that can't be explained by noise or any other weird phenomenon. And the two venues is the X-band Doppler measurement and using the magnetometer, but we got to do proper scaling to get everything down and even perhaps go up in frequency, and that might be an option there. Okay, again, this video series is going to be alongside the railgun videos, but all of these this application series is going to be continued on the Patreon site for Patreon subscribers, with an occasional update and demo released on the YouTube site. And also, I have gotten this thing to finally work, where if you just type in etherealmechanics.com, it'll go right to the Patreon page. You don't have to type in all this other stuff. Both will take you there. Thank you very, very much, especially for all my Patreon subscribers.